Tabernacle in Latin means tent. It was a tent that they could pack up and move with them as they moved. Eventually, Solomon builds his temple, which is destroyed, and then Herod's temple, which is the temple that existed during Jesus' time, until it was destroyed in 70 AD. Permanent temples. But before the permanent temple, there was the tabernacle, the portable tabernacle. The tabernacle was sacred. The tabernacle was holy. The tabernacle was set apart. And God established guidelines to keep the tabernacle pure and holy and apart. So much so that he even gave Moses and his people strict instructions on how to build the tabernacle. Exodus 25:9, you must make it according to all that I show you, God says. The pattern of the tabernacle as well as the pattern of all of its furnishings. Strict guidelines. Everything about the tabernacle, it had to be perfect. Not because it was perfect. It was built by human hands, after all. It wasn't that the tabernacle itself was perfect. But because perfection is born out of obedience. I want to repeat that. Perfection is born out of obedience. God wanted to see obedience from his people. In the flesh, we are far from perfect. In the flesh, we are nothing. In these bodies, we are far from perfect. Although Cassie will tell you that I come as close as there is to that's right, and I'm going to test her to see if they're watching in Indiana this morning. So we'll see if she says anything. But in the flesh, we aren't perfect. But in our obedience to Christ, we are made perfect in him by his blood. Hebrews 5:9. After he, Jesus, was perfected, he, Jesus, became the source of salvation, perfection for all who obey him. The tabernacle wasn't perfect in and of itself, but it was perfectly made out of their obedience to God, their willingness to follow his instructions to a T. And that's the first requirement when it comes to being allowed into the presence of God, allowed into the dwelling place of God, is obedience. Picture of the tabernacle. So here is a rough outline, a very simple outline of the tabernacle. And upon entering the gate, where the arrow is there, to the right, there was only one gate into the tabernacle. One way in. Later on, we see that with Jesus. Jesus is the only gate. Through him, his sheep go. Well, he is the gate, the way, the truth, the life. One gate into the tabernacle. And as the Israelite approached this gate, they would see a bronze altar sitting right there, and a priest at that altar. And before that Israelite would be allowed into the outer courtyard, they would have to sacrifice. They would have to give that priest an unblemished, perfect animal to sacrifice. They would have to confess, repent, and be cleansed by the blood of that animal. Then, once they were cleansed, cleaned by that blood, they were allowed into this pure and holy tabernacle. A water basin sits between the altar and the holy place, or the innermost courtyard. That basin was for the priests, the select priests who were allowed to enter into the holy place. They had to wash themselves. So not only did the priests have to confess and repent and do their thing at the altar, then they had to purify themselves with water, sort of baptism. And once they did that, they were allowed to enter into the holy place. The holy place contained the table, the showbread. This was a bread that symbolized God's desire, his invitation to his people to come and to fellowship with him. There was a lampstand that brought light into a darkness. All of these symbols, all of these elements represent our relationship with God. And then we've got an altar of incense up there. The priests would light incense in the morning, and it would smoke all day, and then they would light it in the evenings, and it would smoke all night. The incense was always, always being lit and lifted. And these represented, the incense represented the prayers of the people being lifted up to God. And then you've got the Holy of Holies, the Ark of the Covenant. Only the high priest was allowed to enter the Holy of Holies. And he could only do so one day a year. And that was on the Day of Atonement, when he would go in and he would offer atonement for all of God's people. And if you went in there impure, you would be struck down dead. If you touched the ark, you'd be struck down dead. Traditions tell us that they would tie a rope to him so that if he died, they would pull him out. That's how they would get him out. The tabernacle. All of these elements, all of these rituals, all of these guidelines, all of these rules. Well, why do they have to do this? Well, why do they have to do that? Why do they have to do that? All of these guidelines was an opportunity for the Israelites, for God's people, to bring glory to God through their obedience, out of which perfection, wholeness, is born. And the same is true for us today. Hebrews 12:2 says, keeping your eyes on Jesus, the source and the perfecter of our faith. Jesus is the one who perfects us. When we obey, when we align our wills to His, we become more Christ-like. Progressive sanctification. We're being made holier and holier each and every day, the more that we live our lives for Christ. It's progressive. We are becoming. We are being made perfect. The more we allow our lives to be guided by the Spirit rather than the world, we become more perfect. The more we allow the Spirit to influence, the more we allow the Spirit to fill us with godly thoughts rather than the filth of the world, we become more perfect. Like that chocolate factory, like the tabernacle. Perfection begins with obedience. There were five kids, only one receives the fullness of the blessing, and that's because it was out of obedience. A disciple is one who obeys the teachings of a master, and Jesus is our master. He is the gate. 1 Corinthians 6:19, do you not know that your body, Paul says, is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God? The portable tabernacle gave way to the permanent temple. The temple became a symbol of identity for the Jews. Up until it was destroyed in 70 AD, the Jews still went there. They worshiped there. They sacrificed there. On Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came, He took up residence not within the walls of brick and mortar, but within each individual believer. We have become the tabernacle. We have become the tabernacle. God is in us, and we take God with us wherever we go. God entered into a personal, communal relationship with each and every believer. Paul even refers to our bodies as tents. He even says that even though on the outside, our bodies are wasting away, there is a treasure that is inside each and every believer. That treasure is Christ. That treasure is eternal. We waste away like tents. We're fragile. We're temporary. But on the inside, we have something that is eternal. That is the presence of God. And because we are the tabernacle, because we are the temple, because God resides within each and every one of us and within each and every one of us believers, we have to keep the tabernacle pure. We have to keep it holy. We've got to keep it sacred, which means capturing the filth as it enters our minds, the desires that come into our minds, capturing them and getting rid of them before they contaminate the rest of the temple, the rest of the tabernacle. 1 Corinthians 6:12 says, Paul says, everything is permissible for me, he says. Meaning, I can do anything I want. Everything's game. I can do whatever I want. And then he goes on and says, but not everything is beneficial. So yeah, I can do whatever I want, but I've got to keep in mind that everything I do may or may not be beneficial. In other words, it could destroy me. It could destroy my relationship with the people around me. It could destroy my relationship with God. The guidelines that God set in place regarding the tabernacle, regarding how we live our lives, is beneficial because they lead us to blessing. They lead us to wholeness. They lead us to perfection. Not a perfection that's here, but a perfection that is to come. If you remember Willy Wonka singing, he's talking about looking beyond your imagination, looking beyond what is here. And as we move through life, we've got to keep that vision. That it's not about what's here, it's about what perfection is to come. Some people, they tell me, I don't like that Bible. I don't want to be a Christian. All that Bible is a list of restrictions. I can't do anything. I can't enjoy life. I can't have fun. Well, I don't look at it as restrictions. I look at it as boundaries. God has given us boundaries. And when we live our lives within those boundaries, we find ourselves fully blessed. We find fulfillment. We find joy. We find peace. We find comfort. But when you begin to step outside of those boundaries, then things begin to happen. While we're here, we're learning to live for God through obedience. We're experiencing God on a deeper level, preparing ourselves for the perfection to come. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 5 says that the tabernacle and its elements serve as a copy and a shadow of heavenly things. The tabernacle is just a foretaste. The temple was just a foretaste. The Spirit is just a foretaste of the glorious things that are to come. Matthew 22, 14, Jesus tells us all of God's children are invited. Everyone is invited, but only a few are chosen. I had a hard time wrapping my mind around that verse. I really struggled with today's sermon. At one point, it was like 20 pages long. I really struggled. All of God's children are invited. We're all invited. The outer courtyard was for everybody. Everybody could go into the outer. We're all invited. But only a few are chosen. And then I remember Jesus in the temple. I remember Jesus overturning the tables, angry. Because they had turned his father's house into something that his father didn't want. He was angry because somewhere along the way, the Jews, the Israelites, stepped outside of the boundaries. They disregarded the guidelines. They turned the sacred temple into nothing more than just another building, another business. They disrespected the holiness. They mocked the gift that God gave them. We must be more than just another building on the block. We must be more than just another person in line at Walmart, than just another person at work, than just another person at school, than just another person jogging on the street. We've got to be more than that because God has set us apart. He dwells within us. We are the house of God. Us. We are the tabernacles of God. I don't want to abuse this gift, this privilege. I don't want to be just another person. I want to be Christ-like. Not just today, but every day. More and more, and to do what I need to do. To wake up each and every day, ready and willing to obey, ready and willing to surrender myself fully to God, to allow Him to use me and to lead me. And as we move through this series, we're going to look at some of these kids like we did this morning with the kids down here, but we're going to look at them in detail. We're going to look at their attitudes and their behaviors. And we're going to look at the kinds of things that do not belong in God's holy tabernacle. Things that we need to capture in our lives and get rid of before they contaminate the tabernacle. Keeping ourselves free from that filth. And it all goes back to obedience. Perfection is born out of what we've got to obey. And in our obedience, in our surrender to Christ, He begins to perfect us. He begins to make us whole. So this morning I invite you to reflect on those words as we go to our invitation hymn, which is I Surrender All, number 408. We'll sing verse 1. And as we lift this hymn to God this morning, let us do so prayerfully. Let us do so emptying ourselves out, surrendering ourselves so that He may refill us with His love and mercy and grace. So let us stand. 408, I surrender all.